Aloha, everybody. Yeah, I'm recording this on a chilly New Year's Eve day, even here in North Carolina. It's wintertime, so I thought I'd wear my loudest Hawaiian shirt, try to warm things up a little bit. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 183, the European HAMNET, with Jan. How do you pronounce your name?
Drashevsky.
Yeah, thank you. DJ 8 NGN. And this is from the 2014 DCC in Austin, Texas. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. We are closing in on the end of the talks from the 2014 DCC. We got this one, and then the next one that's teed up is episode 184. It is on Stream Control Protocol, or SCTP. And then we are done with the individual, the Friday and Saturday presentations from that DCC. Now, if we look here on the schedule, yes, there are two more presentations listed. These are the two that I already produced back in Austin and put online right away. They are Ham Radio Now, episode 164, parts 1 and 2. They're all about Flex Radio's new open APIs for the software that runs their, relatively new 6000 series radios. And then, of course, we've got the Sunday seminar, or the deep dive, as Steve Bible likes to call it. That'll be Chris Testa, KD2BMH, with about 4 hours, minus a few breaks, on FPGA programming for mixed signal systems. And I think we're going to be hearing a lot about what's going on with this white box thing that Chris and Bruce Perrins, K6BP, have been working on. And I'm going to try to work on that this week and maybe get it out for you next weekend if I can. And then we'll finish up the 2014 DCC programs with the Saturday night banquet talk, sort of a keynote address. This will be Flex Radio's founder and CEO, Gerald Youngblood, K5SDR. His talk is titled The Accidental Company, The Making of Flex Radio Systems. Flex Radio is located in Austin. This is where the DCC was held. So you've seen several of their staff members making presentations. The next one is going to be one of their staff guys. They also helped to sponsor the DCC, and they handled a lot of the logistics. But if you were there, you may have noticed, or not noticed, as the case may be, that they didn't plaster their name all over everything. They took a pretty low-key approach to sponsoring the event, so I wanted to acknowledge their participation. Thank you, guys. Okay, take a look at this map. I'm looking at it live. This is the European HAMNET, the network that Jan's going to be talking about, and it looks pretty impressive. And if I understand Jan correctly, this is a high-speed backbone, mostly over amateur radio, although some of these links, I think, pretty much clearly not amateur radio. They can carry just about any kind of digital traffic they want, data, voice, even video. We're not going to learn a lot about how an ordinary ham might use this network, but we're going to learn a lot about what happens under the hood. Now, someday I'd like to do a program on how hams like me might actually use the various high-speed networks that have been presented in this and other DCCs. I'd like to talk to some experts about how we can reconcile ham radio's mission to experiment and advance technology with the need to have stuff that actually works, stuff that lots of hams have, know how to use it every day, so that we are ready to use it in one of our other primary missions, so emergency communications. I have often said that I think we suffer from sort of an embarrassment of riches. Not too many modes. We can never have too many modes. But so many modes, especially digital modes, and we all specialize in the ones that are our favorite. So when it comes time to actually get something done, especially emergency communications, everybody goes off in their own direction. And we don't have perhaps the kind of thing that we criticize public safety communications for, which is good interoperability. They don't all talk to each other. And we like to think that that's one of those chasms that we can bridge. But in our digital communications, maybe not so much. So that's something I would like to do in a future program. Nothing to do with this program, although maybe something to think about as we're watching Jan's talk. And we'll get to Jan's talk after I thank the hams who have supported the Kickstarter that got me out to Austin to record all the sessions and then come back here to our studio in North Carolina. Here's our fabulous Ham Radio Now studio, and get them all produced. 108 hams contributed between $10 and $150 as individuals, and the rest came from what I will loosely refer to as our corporate underwriters. And it starts with these guys.
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
It's Sunday, September 7th, 2014. Time for your Gitmo Nation Media Assassination, episode 650.
This is No Agenda.
Adam Curry is KF5SLN. John C. Dvorak is KJ6LNG. This is not one of those little rinky-dink ham radio podcasts, though. This is a professional operation, and they take on politics, the media, entertainment, anything that they want to. Sometimes they do say something nice about hams, but for everybody else, they pretty much get trashed. You know, I've been looking at their old program on the web for a long time. Let's take a quick look at a new one. I need to move things around so that I can actually play some of their audio.
By the way, we should mention the Chinese that if we get screwed, the whole world's economy collapses and they're screwed too.
Oh, hit it.
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
It's Sunday, December 28th, 2014. Time for your Gitmo Nation Media Assassination. This is
okay. So, John and Adam are live on the internet on Sunday through Thursday at noagendashow.com. You can download it using all the usual podcast apps and listen to it on your schedule. And once again, that is noagendashow.com. We're also brought to you by Tapper. Tapper sponsors the DCC, of course. And if you're interested in anything digital, in amateur radio, hardware, software, data, voice, television, you will find a home in Tapper. If you're getting a lot out of the DCC videos and you're not already a Tapper member, please consider joining. Stop by their website, tapper.org, and check them out. Here's what they look like now. And as you can see, they're talking about getting ready for the 2015 DCC, which will be coming up next September. I don't think they've announced a location for it, but they were looking for something in the upper Midwest. We're also brought to you by several hams who encourage you to check out these folks, hackersforcharity.org. Well, the word hacker has been in the news a lot lately. You know, with the Sony's little problem allegedly from North Korea. I heard somebody on Twitter say they don't want to call people who do that kind of thing hackers. They prefer to call them computer criminals. But I'm afraid the general media is stuck on hackers. So Hackers for Charity might be fighting a kind of an uphill battle for recognition of the positive definition of hacking, using computer skills to do something good. But that's who they are. Hackers for Charity was founded by Johnny Long. He figured out that he and you could use your computer skills to help out people around the world who really need you, but can't begin to afford you. So maybe you can help. Check him out at hackersforcharity.org. We're also brought to you by these guys, the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force. They are at aretf.org. Now, today's program is all about building an extensive ham radio digital network, the European HAMNET. I'm guessing they did their best to follow good engineering practice, but there's not a lot of solid documentation about best practices in amateur radio, especially for digital networks. So Brian, K7UDR, and Kenny, KU7M, launched the ARETF. It's patterned after the IETF, the Internet Engineering Task Force. Their guiding principle is that you can't tell people what to do, especially hams. You have to form a consensus, and maybe most people will adopt a standard formed from a general agreement. So if this interests you, you can still get in on the ground floor. Stop by aretf.org and follow the blog so that you can keep up to date. And I'm looking live once again at this website. And come on, guys. The last thing you put up there was October 13th. So it is time to update the ARETF. Maybe you need to give them a little kick in the pants. Finally, we're brought to you by an enthusiastic supporter of Ham Radio Now and Tapper who wishes to remain anonymous. This ham is a regular attendee of the DCC for over 30 years He's very enthusiastic about what the DCC and Ham Radio Now are doing together. And if you didn't get in on the Kickstarter and you want to support Ham Radio Now, well, you can. Stop by our website, hamradionow.tv. You will find our mascot. There he is over on the right. Arvin, little piggy bank. Click on him and he'll take you to our contribution page where you can use PayPal or a credit card. And my thanks to everyone who contributes to Ham Radio Now and the Kickstarter. And now, back to Austin, TAPR President Steve Bible, N7HPR, will chicken out on pronouncing Jan's last name.
All right, welcome back from lunch. I hope everybody enjoyed lunch. And we've got a really good program this afternoon. And starting off, we'll have, and I don't know if I can even go for the last name here, so I'll go for Jan, so DG8NGN. And I understand that's a vanity call sign for Next Generation Network. Okay, I've been told by a little bird on that. And he's going to talk to us about the European HAMNET, a large-scale high-speed radio network. Go ahead, Don.
Thank you very much. I'm going to talk about the European HAMNET, which is a very large-scale high-speed radio network. My name is Jan Draszewski, and the call sign is DG8NGN, and I'm from the German Amateur Radio Club, DRLC. And this, I suggest that we start with opening up the notebooks and type in the URL you have in there, hamnetdb.net. So you could follow the talk a little bit easier. So on the right side, we see a typical installation. We have some interlinks, interlink antennas, and we have four user access antennas, including the transceivers, which are nano stations from Ubiquiti, in four directions. So who am I? I'm the VHF, UHF microwave manager from our club, and I'm also active in frequency management. We need to fight against the people who want to catch all of our spectrum. So I'm pretty active in that area right now. I'm in the 44Net IP coordination team together with Thomas from Berlin and Egbert. And I'm one of the founders of the ISCDDB network. You might be aware of that. This is a network for where we use our D-Star radios on. Together with Hans-Jürgen DL5DR and Michael DL1BFF from Berlin. So in my profession, I'm a system engineer for spectrum monitoring systems at Rohde & Schwarz. You may be aware of it in Munich, in the headquarters. Okay, my abstract, well, this is the only thing what it made into the proceedings. Unfortunately, time was very short, so I'll just skip that. You all have this in the proceedings. Yeah, about the network. What we see here now is most of Germany, Austria, Switzerland, some parts of France, and I want to describe a little bit what we see here. So the approximately size is, let's say, 1,000 by 1,000 kilometers. And the red dots are inactive nodes. The green ones are active nodes. Some green have, like these here, they have a U in there, which means they have a user access. And between these nodes, these are inactive. These are, maybe in future we will use them here. And sometimes we cannot connect the full network by radio. So what we do is we use normal VPN technology in order to connect all these islands together. This goes by L2TP or by IPIP. Yeah, and what is difficult here is we have here Germany, and if we cross the border, different rules apply. So we need to find out how we can get in touch with each other, either by, let's say, ISM connections on public Wi-Fi, or we go by VPN, or even we have the same spectrum we can share, and then we can use normal radio links on the amateur bands. That doesn't work anymore? Ah, it does. Yeah, this is our standard deployment example. We use here some microtic devices. We have the router here with some passive power over Ethernet, which goes by the LAN cable directly to the device. Here we have a typical mid-range antenna, which is 23 dBi and I think 1 watt output power or something on 5 gigahertz. And here, if we want to make any longer range connections, then we go for the 30 dBe antennas. And yeah, for the user access, we are lucky the band from 2,320 to 2,400 we have in the spectrum in Germany, so we can use it for access without any disturbance from the normal public Wi-Fi network. Yeah. Then we have a typical example that we have seen on the first page with some Ubiquiti hardware, which we usually use for directly peer-to-peer connects and for user access. These are the 4 devices we have seen on the first page. They are 16 dBi and up to 27 dBm output power. Personally, I prefer a little bit the microtic stuff because you have more options for tweaking the installation, especially if we are talking about point-to-multipoint installations where we put user access on top of it. Sometimes you need to check whether these antennas and the transceivers, whether the antennas are fitting all the frequency ranges you want to use. So usually you get from the manufacturer a normal chart where you can see frequency over gain. So if you hit the right frequency, then you have the full gain. Otherwise, you might lose some of these 23 dBi. Now about some of the network management and the principles we use for the IP allocations. I want to keep the experimental nature of amateur radio live. So what we designed is we just give out IP addresses and so-called AS numbers, which are used on the internet. An AS is a normal autonomous system called. And we have per autonomous system roughly around about 15 to 20 nodes inside. And this will create a region. And a region can have a single different administrator. So it doesn't need to be administrated, the full network doesn't need to be administrated by just one people or just a small group. But we just give out the resources in order to do it on their own and give some instructions how to do this. So they are able to learn a lot of how to do backbone networking. What we do is we have each region will speak to the other regions by the external BGP protocol. Who has heard about BGP so far? Okay, all right, that's good. And the IP addresses to deploy the network are usually coming from the IP coordination team, which is Brian Cantor here. He's maintaining the 44/8 network, somewhere around maybe. And here in Germany, we have 2 blocks. It's 44.130/16 and 44.224/15, which is the new range where we deployed all our HamNet stuff. So each region needs an AS number. For that to work, we don't use the public AS numbers from the IP from the internet. We are using the private AS space, which is defined in the RFC 1930, which is 64512 to 65535, at least in that RFC. And what we did is we said, okay, this is our web page where we put all the information for the German allocations on. So we can find there how we split it or how we associated the different AS numbers which are in the private space to the different countries so far. And if a new country is coming up, we just say, okay, there's enough place here. We could find some place for the new country then. But it's already a little bit, we need to take care not to waste all these numbers because they are limited right now. Anyway, there's no real coordination for that so far. We just say, okay, another country appeared who has interest in the HamNet. Let's just give them a block of AS numbers. And the AS numbers need not to be into, in any order. So you could even have different AS numbers to the same country. Okay. Yeah, now we requested I have seen in the 32-bit range for the AS numbers, I haven't seen any allocations for private usage, so we requested it. And as you can see, in July 2013, the RFC 6996 considered to have the new range, which is a very large number here. So we can even use this right now. But it's not coordinated yet. It's just for experiments and thoughts how we can do the coordination on this. Yes.
What's an AS number?
It's an autonomous system number. It's just a number for a region, and you need that in order to connect different regions by the BGP protocol. All right? Okay. How do we solve the routing inside a region? Since we say that each region is free to use the favorite routing protocol, you could experiment by OLSR, by Batman, OSPF, or internal BGP, for example. And internal BGP is very often used. If you maintain a full mesh in an iBGP network, this is going to be not too easy to maintain because you need to have a full mesh. And with each node, the number of links will rise. And that is really a pain to administrate then. So we think about how to solve it. We go by the route reflector, which is unfortunately a single point of failure then. So this was not a good solution either. And then we found out that we could use a BGP confederation, which means that you have in your region, you can, we reserved some AS numbers for that purpose. And so each site in that area will get its own AS number, which is used internally, and for external communication, eBGP is used. That is for the routing. So let's see. So how do we go on with the deployment of the sites? I have seen, did you open up the hamnetdb.net already? So this is all the extracts of that site. And there, you just pick one of the maintainers in that list on that site. Maybe you know some of them. If not, just ask me. Then you can create an account on that platform. And we have already roughly 150 maintainers of networks there. So they maintain not only networks, but even sites in order to find out which site can you interconnect to each other. So, how can we create a new site? We log into the hamnetdb.net, click on sites, press new site, fill in the data like call sign, descriptive name, latitude, longitude, and meters above ground, which is very important. Not the sea level, but it's ground. And you put in the separated list of maintainers. If you do this, you know, there has been a shutter radar topography mission once with the space shuttle around the world in order to get the hate data of the full world. And this is public available. And with that data, we can easily calculate the Fresnel zone we can easily calculate the terrain between two points in the Earth. We use a website from heywhatsthat.com. In order to create these pictures, you just give in the frequency, you give the parameters of the coordinates, and you will get this out of it. So what we have here is if you put in your site in here, you just look up your site and there's a an area which says other sites nearby. And then you have a list and you just click here on the profile and you get an easy way whether you have direct line of sight or not. And if you have, you can be pretty sure the link will work. It doesn't matter how long it is. We can even run it on 150 kilometers without any problems, if you have line of sight.
Excuse me, what was that website?
HamNetDB.net. That's exactly, yeah. Okay. A little bit about link budget calculation. This is very common. You check the data sheet of your transceiver. It says it has some gain, you have some TX power, and TX power at the highest modulation and coding scheme is 24 dBm. So this is the worst case scenario. And the worst case for MCS7 reception, which is capable to have the full rate, is minus 78 dBm. And again, check the losses of the antenna gain by looking in the chart gain versus frequency if provided by the manufacturer. We don't care about these because these are for 802.11g, and nowadays we already use 802.11n, and this is where we work with MCS values for the different coding schemes. All right, so you can easily find any calculation tool on the internet in order to put in the values we just have. The link we have just seen has 38 kilometers, which is in here. Then you put the output power in here, the antenna gain, and you will get the receiving level. That's it. And with that receiving level, we have, still 7 dB left for inaccuracy. For example, that there are some losses in the cables or whatever. So this is valid for a 20 megahertz bandwidth signal. If you go down to 10 megahertz, you will get 3 dB more gain, respectively 6 dB narrowing down to 5 megahertz. But the throughput will suffer with the same factor. So if you lower the bandwidth, you will get 3 dB more gain, but you will lose bandwidth, what you can get through the link, by a half. So since we have horizontal and vertical polarization, we can use two special streams, and we get a result of 130 megabit brutto, not netto. So we can transfer a lot of data in there, in that channel. Why is that number here? It's the guard interval. The guard interval is possible from 802.11n. There's an option that you can shorten the guard interval for the inter-symbol interference might be affected there, and so you need to take care of whether you can use it or not on your link. Okay, now we come to spectrum regulatory. Before deploying a radio link, you need to check the rules which apply for your country. In Germany, automatic radio stations need a special license. They get a special license like DB0XYZ. Is it Y? Yeah. From regulation authority. It's called BNetzA. And it's currently 200 US per call once. You don't need to reassign for it. And different rules will apply per band or even per frequency range. For example, we are not allowed on automatic stations to run more than 15 watts ERP above 30 megahertz, and we are limited to 10 megahertz bandwidth, which is not too good. But we can, even with that parameters, can get a good network. Then we need to look on our spectrum allocation status. So we are secondary user. We're not a primary user in that bands. And so we need to request for a license, and the request will go to the primary user to check whether we can use the frequency there, because it might be blocked already by the primary user. And then it gets denied. And usually it takes roughly 4 to 5 months until you get your license and you applied for it. So sharing is Wi-Fi. At least this is valid for Germany. If you look what Wi-Fi can do with the parameters, we have maximum output of 15 watts. Wi-Fi has 1 watt if it's using dynamic frequency selection and transmit power control. They don't need a license. We need a license. We are bandwidth limited. They are not. And we have further restrictions like no identify. We need to identify. We need to have no encryption. Limited content we can transfer there, which is more or less no restrictions here, but they need to implement the radar detection in that bands. So is it all worth, just for 12 dB, more gain to use amateur radio rather than Wi-Fi? I think yes, the reason will come. So if you are able to run a link with ISM parameters, just do so. Why not? So it saves some more spectrum we can use for amateur radio then. What happens if you try to share with radars? We don't have any problem there because we have our license there and we have seen that the primary user is okay with that. But you can see here, the Wi-Fi emissions without radar detection are disturbing weather routers. Here, some rain in Romania or Hungary or in Croatia. But what is not rain is what you see in Slovakia and Poland this year. Yeah? So you see that circle? And this circle is exactly stopping here. So the radar is hit by a Wi-Fi signal and thinks that here's rain. This will happen if you don't take care on spectrum sharing. Good. So we don't share even by, we even share by other amateur radio applications. We look in the IAU band plan, we look into national band plans. What we have even heard yesterday is end of modes. You remember? And we are running different kind of digital links right now. Digital ATV, packet radio, HamNet. But we're trying to set up our band plans just to reflect the bandwidth we are using, not the application types. So if we do so, we can just carry all our data in a special bandwidth. For example, we can carry TCP IP and DATV links, or we can carry HamNet. HamNet can carry IPTV or packet radio. So all we need to do is to build a very large backbone and run all our applications on it. Yeah, let's talk about identification. Radio amateurs need to identify in regular intervals. I think it's 10 minutes here in the US. The very easy way is the ESSID, but how do you find out if you have this SSID, which station is really transmitting them? Because you have an access point and you have a client and you will not find out which one is who now. So you can have a convention. If you take the first one in AP mode and the second one in station mode, then it's clear. But how to handle then this point to multipoint link? So this is not a satisfying situation. What we did once, because in the early beginning from the HamNet, we were able to test new stuff by Article 16 of our law in Germany, if you provide a very detailed plan how to identify and how to take care on all the stuff we need. So what we designed is there's a bit from the MAC addresses that you can locally administered set a MAC address. You know that the MAC addresses come normally by vendor, but if you decide to put another MAC address in, you're free to do so. So what we did is we encoded the call sign, even with some SSID, into the MAC address. So you could identify by MAC address, but it's very complicated and not very useful. So What we have here is we have neighbor discovery protocols like Cisco discovery protocol or Microtik neighbor discovery protocol or whatever. And you just set your identify call sign in that little box. And then if you do a neighbor list scan, you see that broadcast will come every minute. And this is enough for identification. So just put in the call sign and that's it. For the deployment, we have a 44.224/50 network for full German HAMNET. And we decided to split them into so-called backbone networks and user service networks. And the backbone networks for each region, they will get a /23. And for the deployment of user and services, they will get a /22. So each region will get its own IP address space and its own AS number. This is even reflected in the HamNet database, hamnetdb.net. So we see here the AS numbers, and we see, let's see on the next page, we see all the IP address resources which are belonging to a special AS number. So how are we going to do the IP subnetting then? We found out that best practice is that each single site has just one BGP router, or one router at all. We will get a /27 network for the site, not the region, but the site. And from the maintainer from the region, the site will get a /27 network. And we will keep the next one free in order, if the IP address space is not enough, then you could extend it to the /26. So the site network will be announced by the router to the network. And the site network can be splitted internally into more different networks as you like a /28 for users or a /28 for services. Why do you want to have this? Because of easy firewalling. I divide into controlled area and uncontrolled area. So the controlled area is where I deploy my services in. Usually you want to have, let's say, your D-star repeater or all your stuff you put on the site, you want to have to connect, have a connection to the internet. And I'm allowing the internet for the full site, but for the users, I don't allow it. I just allow 44/8 for them. So I can easily set a firewall rule in order to say that only my services are allowed and the users, which I have no control of because they are coming from RF, they cannot go into the internet from here. Yeah. For the interconnection, we use simply /29 network and we start from zero and just go up until we have a lot of transfer networks in the region. That's it. This is very nice to know. If you know the HamNetDB provides a very good network management. And you can, if you know this data structure inside, you can work very, very good with it. A host belongs always to a site. You need to define it when you create a host. And a host belongs automatically to a subnet. If you have a subnet and you have an IP address, then it's by nature, if the IP address is in the subnet, then it belongs to the subnet. That's it. And the subnet belongs to an AS, which is, again, user-defined. And the HamNetDB is able to visualize this data. So this is an example from Munich on our student home. And you can see we have here a backbone network, which is deployed on 44.224.10.48/29 on that frequency here. And we know this IP address is in there and that IP address is in there. And since this IP address is belonging to DB0ZM and this IP address in the same network is belonging to DB0TVM, it automatically knows that there must be a link between them. And so the traffic will come automatically up. Okay. On the overview of the DB0 ZM station, we can see all the hosts which are inside. If they are green, they are active. If they are red, they are currently down. You can assign some DHCP range for local services or for the users. And this is very neat. You see here, edited last time. And I need to mention that you see the record. It's already 667 days old. And everything is recorded in that. So you have a history. You don't will lose any data. The data will be backupped each day. And the history is from the beginning of the entry available. You can even show what is happening there. And then you have all the maintenance in there. If somebody else is changing this value, he will do that under his name. So you will see who has edited the records the last time. It's me and it's Flory. Okay, so this is this is an automatic system, how it DB0 ZM, this is our surrounding subnets you see here. It has three links. It has one side network. And it belongs to one AS. And the next nearby stations, you can see here. The list is even longer than the page. So this is a document of the station. You see one microtic board here with the two links, another board with two links. Here some camera servers. Here Raspberry Pi and switch. And on the lower part, you see all the other stuff in here, NetIO and a server, another Raspberry Pi, a URI board for the old Starlink network, and so on. So this is how we document, or at least I document, some do not. Okay. How is a typical user setup? A user has its own DSL router, and it has a default route. And you can, on the most routers, you can set a special route like 44/8 should go over another device within the network. So you could decide that this router should send all the packages which are belonging to the HamNet or the AMPRNet should go that way because you know the IP address of that device in there. And you just set the IP address and all devices in your local network are on. That's it. And for that reason, again back, keep 44/8 for radio amateurs only. This is very important to let this work. Okay, deployment of DNS. This is, yeah. Germany has currently a national DNS concept under the domain de.ampr.org, which is the domain of the 44 net IP address space. And the HamNetDB automatically can generate all the DNS zone files, what you need in order to set up your server. And so you can run on each region, each AS could run, if them like, to a DNS server. But we are offering a service that all the entries you put in the HamNetDB are automatically synced with the DNS hub in Germany. That is my station at the University of Applied Sciences in Nuremberg. And they are going to the flat ampr.org zone once a day. And there's a data flow diagram. Well, I will skip that. It's posted on the 44net list once. But you can get this presentation afterwards. So how do I interconnect with the international world then? You may be aware of that portal.ampr.org where you could deploy your 44net stuff. And I have a big machine at the university and it will import all the IP routes which are available on the 44 network are imported and sent on the BGP network of the HamNet. And the other way around, I registered my gateway at portal.ampr.org for that these subnets. So all the international traffic will come for these subnets will come at the university. And there we'll put it into the HAMNET. So we have an interconnection, an international interconnection on the IPAP network right now. Even for this, we have some data flow diagrams. So I even want to interconnect by packet radio, which is very, very neat. I learned all my TCP/IP knowledge just by looking at the AX25 stack. Because it was so slow, I got all my knowledge about the IP and TCP and all the things on top. So you can easily read how SMTP works. That's really, really, really nice. So we have in Germany, we have a node on the packet radio network. It's called iGate. It's a virtual call. And if you have connection to the packet radio world on the FlexNet network, then you are able to connect to that node here. And here, you can see this is my packet radio terminal. I just connected to my repeater, connected to iGate. I looked up the RP entries in there. You can see already one of my fixed IP address. We are using for that node a special IP address range, which is 44.130.254/24. And it's split into a dynamic range and a fixed range. So if anybody comes and wants to have a fixed IP address, I will give it out. If not, they just go to iGate, type in get IP, like here, iGate. So this is Bernd, DL3RMFO, he's sitting there. And he connects to the iGate, get an IP address. And if I look up the ARP entries here, you can see there's a dynamic new entry with the call DL4MFO, and it's valid for 40 days. And this is, if you run an IP stack on your Windows XP, I think 7, it's not possible with that solution, then you can have a normal packet radio call to iGate, and here you can see the IP header, the ICMP header from the ping, and you will get the answer. So what I did is he connected by packet radio to that node and pinged one IP address, which is in the Washington area. 10 minutes left, good. So motivation. Why are we doing that? Well, my easy answer is it's a hobby I don't care about. No, seriously, most administrators just want to attach their repeater systems on the internet. So my question is now, you're doing that usually by using these address pools. You could even apply for a NAT44 address and go for it. Even if you don't have or don't see the benefit right now, you could do this, and we could interconnect you to the AMPR network later on. So the connection to the NAT44 provides, we can provide and use services which are only available on NAT44. We have a trusted network. Packets from NAT44 are supposed to come from an amateur radio operator. That if you know, we could, I know that some are complaining about this, but that's true and valid for now. I'd ask for Brian. And we can provide gateways to ARRF even without further authentication of the individual amateur, because we know that NAT44 is amateur radio. And what is very nice is we could have end-to-end communication. So everybody's struggling around with that Echolink setup at home. We need to adjust the router, put the port forwarding in, and so on. And we could get rid of it if we just use the NAT44 with end-to-end communication. You don't need to struggle with port forwarding. Each device has a single IP. We want to build a large RF backbone. And you can compare it with packet radio. Packet radio was a backbone network, and you run BBS on it. You run services on top. And what we're doing now is we run services on top on a very high-speed network for DATV, voice over IP, packet radio, whatever you can transport on TCP/IP, you're free to do. We will build an independent network for emergency communication. At least some do. This is where the funding could come from. And of course, it's cool because we can. Yeah, and again, the motivation is learning and experimenting. You build your own internet, and you get in touch with technology you have never seen before. Usually, you have your DSL router, and you can get an idea how to deploy a home network, but you don't get an idea how to deploy a backbone network, and which is not necessarily needed for it. So this is what we learn here, and we even learn how to build our own backhaul with gigahertz wave propagation, system integration of these devices. So some examples. Here's some example. There's a FM repeater group. Here, the red lines. The main repeater controller is here, and 1, 2, 3 other repeater stations, which are interconnected by HamNet, are connected to the main controller, and it's working pretty good. Here we have in South Tyrol, where we have all the mountains we have just seen, we have a setup which is not connected by the internet, as far as I know. I'm not sure about it, but they are using the Osterlink software in order to have a repeater network. Here we have ATV live streaming with different users, so they log into the HamNet and then they are able to share video streams. And we even have a social network on it. And you don't want to expose this to the internet, so for that reason we want to have a closed network for it. And we have even some search engines like JC, I don't know how to spell it, but we are working on that. We have some web SDRs. Currently, there we have some contest ongoing in Europe. We could later on have a look in the spectrum on our web SDR receivers. They are, of course, available on the internet as well because there's no need to block it out. But they are even in the network. And this is my favorite. We built these high-tech cams, which makes pictures like this. You will wonder what it is, but this is from a high mountain. This is the skiing area. We have some clouds. It's during the night. So the city is down below. We have the sky and some, yeah, I don't know, UFOs? I don't know. So you could surf by that website. It's really neat to have a look on photo-webcam.eu. So what do we need to do now? We need more bands. We have heard about 9 centimeter. It's a little bit more expensive. I have seen some 3 centimeter equipment. We have one link running on that. We have some free to use 24 gigahertz in the license free band, but it's very short range only. But what about this? How about self-mating up converters and down converters? We could run a Microtik N-Stream Dual, which means you can have one card in TX mode and one card in ARX mode.
Hey, just one thing. So you mentioned 9 centimeters. Anybody that's interested in getting into that, please see me. I have some older but still very good 802.11a based radio cards for the 3 gigahertz band that'll cover the top 100 megahertz here in the U.S. I don't know what your band is over there, but see me. They're free, but you actually got to do something with them. I'm Brian, KB9MCI.
All right. So what else? We need some filtering. What I have seen so far that these devices are very cheap, and so far you can see a signal which is 10 megahertz broad. You can see 40 megahertz above and even below. So for that, we need some filtering in order to get rid of these emissions we see there. And if you have a site which is very, very crowded, trust me, you want to do this because you cannot run too many links on there. Yeah, we need definitely some better routing protocols which take into account the packet loss, the changing of the throughput due to adaptive modulation. and which take the quality of the link into account. Otherwise, we get some flapping routes, unreliable connections, and so on. We could try out some of the designed protocols for mesh networking. But yeah, for that thing, we have some regions. And each region is free to use their own protocols. And it's really done. We have some of them using OSR, and we have some with OSPF on the network. What else do we need to do? We need to have some more user access technology. And this is the main problem and my main concern. The connectivity is much more important than the speed. You could exchange email with a very low bandwidth, you know? And if you reduce the bandwidth, the noise gets down and you get some longer range. And it's much better for non-line of sight requirements if you go on the lower bands. So my wish list is to see some equipment which can run these bandwidths in the 70 centimeter band, or these bandwidths in the 23 centimeter band, which is a little bit, yeah. We might see what happens with the Galileo system in the UE, because they are running on 1260 to 1300. What we did, we already run D-star DD mode as a user access on the network 44. This is very neat. And we are, by the way, we are about to finish the implementation of D-star DD on the ATOS B210. We are not far away anymore. We need to have some more, access to network 44 needs to be definitely improved by RF, more sites, more bands, more technology, by VPN, by IPAP, even by BGP direct connected networks. So we need more material to convince local ISPs to let us announce the network 44 IP address space on the internet. And we need some better instructions for the users, easy ways to connect, and just a better worldwide concept. And now the visions come. In the long-term view, I really want to have an intranet for radio amateurs. We want to create a huge intranet with using the NET 44 IP address space. And the user should be able to provide services for other radio amateurs. What I can think of, some people of you are doing ATV transmissions. You know that they are not exposed on the internet. So for that reason, you're just free to use it, and you're happy that other radio amateurs will see it. But if you're using a normal webcam on the internet, you don't let it run all the time. You just want to have your link partners or your users see it. But I could imagine that some people would even run their webcam just for radio amateurs. And this is what I say here. We try to get people on the net in order to get end-to-end communication. And you just set up at home your webcam, and everybody else on the net 44 could access this, but not all the people from the internet. So the chicken egg problem needs to be solved by content on the network, like the Hamburg or the search engines. So you need to have some content. To be honest, I really don't have too much knowledge about what we are doing there. I'm just responsible for the backbone, more or less. And this is the most biggest problems I think we need to solve in the next future, maybe on the ARRTIF. we need a very huge authentication platform which is valid for worldwide. We have some ARRL Logbook of the World certificates which we can use for cross certification, which is already used. But we need to have it very, very simple. And we need a very, very easy solution in order to get program authors to adapt this technology and to solve the authentication problem. Just imagine if you want to write an application where your radio amateurs coming from the internet wants to go on RF, you always have this question valid. That's it. So Q&A. Yes, please.
So I'm curious, just looking at your map and seeing all your sites, are those typically ham users' homes, or do you have good access to tower space and buildings, or what's your typical backbone type installation look like?
We have towers, we have mountains, and it depends. If you have some activity, you have a very active region, in Wuppertal, in the Cologne area, in that area, there are so many hams that they even share the network 44 from house to house. So this is very neat. So it's like the other maybe you know Freifunk. This is a, I don't know how to translate it. If you have only short distance hops, then they share internet usually. And what we are doing, we're sharing a little bit longer hops with the nearest amateur radio nearby. So this is what we do, yes.
You're using the MikroTik software on the MikroTik hardware for your installations, rather than some open source product?
We do both. We do both. We use the open protocols with different vendors. So some are using the WRT54, for example, and they run their another firmware image, or they use Quacker or Zebra on it to do the routing. So we are free to use what we have.